So Looking Glass Sound, the plot of Looking Glass Sound is essentially the story of Wilder, who's a 16-year-old in 1989, and he goes on holiday to Maine with his family, and he's determined, the first line of the novel is, I plan on falling in love this summer. And in a way, he does, although not in the way he expects, because he makes one of those friendships that, those passionate friendships that you only make when you are of that age, almost as potent and as intense as falling in love. And he and his two best friends, Harper and Nat, who he meets that summer, have a terrible experience due to this predator who's stalking the town, called the Dagger Man, who sneaks into children's bedrooms and takes pictures of them with a Polaroid camera. And the parents only ever know that he's been there because they get sent to the Polaroids. So this all culminates in a terrible coming-of-age catastrophe. And then Harper and Nat and Wilder's lives are affected forever by these incidents. And it's about processing their trauma, the traumatisme, I think it is in French. And they all try various ways of trying to process what happened that summer. And Wilder becomes a writer. It becomes a question of who has the right to tell a story, who has the authority to say what really happened, who owns a story. And it's very much my love letter to Stephen King country and to writing in general. There's a line in it that says, writers are monsters. We eat everything we see. And I think that is the core of the book. You know, there's this almost parasitic, like, consumptive thing that happens when writers approach their subjects. And Looking Glass Sound, or Mirror Bay, as it is in France, is... how do we reflect back through the looking glass our experiences, and how much truth, and how much does it matter if something is true factually, if it's true emotionally? What worth are stories? And the bay is called Looking Glass Sound in one of the fictional versions of it that happens throughout the book. It's a layering of writers and writing, and how writing adds to and also perhaps distorts our reality. My taste or my compulsion to layer narratives or layer stories and mix genres, I think this is partly a Gothic strategy, and I consider my heritage very much not just horror but very much the Gothic novel. And one of the things the Gothic novel does and its roots are in is that it has the semblance of evidence or testimony. So it's fragmented pieces where the story emerges in the gaps between the narratives. Not through the narratives themselves. You have first-hand witnessing of something that happened. And the important thing is each person believes that they are telling the truth. There are no liars. Nobody is trying to mislead you. But the story grows up in the gaps between what we cannot know while we're living something and what the reader should... What the reader will essentially know more than the characters by the end. And this distorting function of nesting and layering narratives. I think genre is a funny word. So it's both, as with everything to do with books, it's both useful and not useful at all. It does both. And I think horror is something, horror as a genre is something that, there's a wonderful description of it, which is that it's not a genre at all. It is a parasite or a virus that attaches itself to genre and mutates and travels through time. I think this is the best expression I've ever heard of for it. So for me, it's not a mixture of genres. It's just horror infecting other genres as it goes. Looking Glass Sound is absolutely a coming-of-age novel. It's about that time in our lives where everything is completely new. Not only do we not know who we are, but we don't know what the world is, what it means. Everything is fresh. And because it's fresh, the new blade cuts the sharpest, you know. It can hurt you more than anything. I think that there's almost no time as intense as that. Stephen King, again, does this beautifully. He understands how this time in your life where you're just in the process of becoming can be so formative and also so painful. And in a way, I think there's also, I write in the book, you know, maybe the rest of one's life sometimes is just a repetition or an attempt to recapture that intensity that happens in those early days. I'm not sure that's true, but I think for some people, if they're deeply imprinted enough, it can feel like that. So it's both a wondrous and also a terrifying thing that something can affect you, so you can be left so open to fear and love and all these things.